हेलो एवरीवन, टुडे वी आर स्टार्टिंग विद द इवोल्यूशन ऑफ द साइबर लॉ. सो इन दिस स्लाइड और इन दिस मॉड्यूल वी विल बी कवरिंग ईच एंड एवरी एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ द साइबर लॉ दैट इज रिलेटेड टू द एंटायर इंटरनेट वर्ल्ड और मे बी टेक्नोलॉजिकल रिलेटेड वर्ल्ड. सो हाउ दिस पर्टिकुलर लॉ इज इवॉल्व विद टाइम, वाई द ट्रेडिशनल लॉ इज नॉट एप्लीकेबल इन द साइबर वर्ल्ड. After studying cyberspace, we need to know what all laws are there that are applicable over internet while you are transacting or anyway while you are communicating anything over internet. Now, moving forward, in this particular slide, we would be starting with the introductory part as to what cyber law is, what we are going to study. And then we would be coming up to the need as per the requirement. As in the interpretation of statutes, we have studied that every law comes into existence because there is a requirement of that particular law. So in order to understand that, we would be studying what is the requirement and what is the need of the cyber law and how is it applicable in the world of internet. Now we would be connecting the topic internet and cyber laws and how this particular law is evolved with time. And then after that, we would also be studying the applicability of this law in India. As you know, the internet is not confined. You don't know the limit of internet, same as we would be studying the limitations of the cyber law as to where and when it's applicable. So now we have law because we have crimes related to that thing. So in order to understand that, we would be studying about those laws and the crimes on which such law is applicable. Moving forward with the objectives of this slide, that means moving forward to know as to what do you mean by this particular law. So here we would try to understand with the slides, with this module, that what is the importance of such law. Then we will also try to understand what all things are included in such law, cyber law. We will also understand where this law is applicable in order to define the particular limit of that law. And then we would be studying the jurisdictional issues. As you know, it's not confined to a particular country, to a particular area or a particular town. It has a very wide ambit. So we would be trying to understand that. After that, we would be studying the applicability of this law in India. Why? Because here we are trying to understand the application of such law and the applicability of this law in the India itself. We are here confined to India because as we are going to study IT Act, that is cyber law, which is applicable in India. Why? Because there are different laws in the different countries that are prevailing. So here we are only confined to the laws that are related to in India. So we will know the application of the cyber law in India. And after that, at last, we would be studying the implement issues that are there in the cyber laws. So in all, we are going to study importance, what all things are included, where it is applicable, what are the jurisdictions, and then what is the applicability of this law in India, and then and lastly we would be studying the implementation issues. So these are the very objective of studying this particular law, or you can say the importance of the cyber law. Moving forward, coming to the introductory part, so before making you understand, let me talk about a particular very famous case, that is R versus Gold. What happened in this case was there was this person. Let me take an example of A and B. So where the person A, here we would be taking all the examples that are related to the, basically which are related to the cyber world. So here computers, networks, mobile phones, technology. In every example, I would be using that. So if I take an example where A and B are the two persons and the one person has got an unauthorized access to someone other's computer. Like, for example, two persons are using internet and I am able to access your information. Like, A here in this example is able to use the information that is available in the B's laptop. So this is known as unauthorized access to a computer network. Clear? So here, this person was charged with the forgery and counterfeiting. Why? Because he is trying to defraud, because he is trying to create a false instrument. Under which act? That is mentioned in the slides. You all can read. That is Forgery and Counterfeiting Act of 1981. So this was the basic example, this was the basic background I was giving you to let you know that what we are going to study in the particular module. Now moving forward, here we are trying to understand, does this criminal charge jo us pe lagaya gaya hai would be enough or not? See, now here there's a person A who is getting an unauthorized access to some other person, and here you are putting a charge of defraud. So what do you think? Is it a good charge? Does this charge sounds right? Why? If your answer is yes, then why? Because if I'm having an unauthorized access, why would be I have charged with defraud or the false instrument? And secondly, why? If no, then what is the requirement? What is the need of the R? So to answer all these questions, let's move forward with the other slides. Now in this case, what happened was, House of Lords, this was not an Indian case, this was the US based case. So what happened? House of Lords says that according to them, the conclusion was not intended. Clear? According to them, what happened? The charges that were given was not proper. So here they were trying to actually know ki what should happen to the person who has gained the unauthorized access. So the appellant's conduct in this particular act was not desirable, and you can say that was not considered to be valid. Clear? So this was the whole idea of this particular slide. Moving forward, the judgment that we discussed, where we took the example of A and B, that is R versus Gold, this judgment brought the possibilities of the cyber crimes that we are studying in this particular slide, that is cyber law, and the inadequacies of the existing law to deal with them, to notice the legislature of the Great Britain. Clear? So it led to the enactment of a particular act, and that we discussed before. We discussed the act of, what do you call it, forgery act. Now here there was an enactment of the new law that is totally different, that is totally based upon the computers, and this act is known as Computer Misuse Act of 1990. Do you see how recently we have got this act, that is before, just before 30 years before 1990? That means very recently we have got this particular act that is applicable to the crimes where one person is getting the unauthorized access to the other person's account. This was among the first cyber laws that was enacted. Clear? So just remember, Computer Misuse Act of 1990 in the Great Britain, which has brought the various possibilities of committing this crime, cyber crime, has brought the different types of crimes into the existence of law, into the ambit of law. So this was the first ever cyber laws that were enacted all over the world. Secondly, another act was implemented in the year 1996, that is after 6 years, that is known as Telecommunication Act of 1996 in US. So followed by the Computer Misuse Act, we have Telecommunication Act in US. Now there is something known as Unisectoral Model Law. So uniform international standards lane ki bahut zarurat aa gayi thi. Why? Because we need a common platform. As cyberspace has a common platform, we require a common platform for a particular law itself. So with this Unisectoral Model on the Electronic Commerce in 1996 itself, that is after the 6 years of passing of the Computer Misuse Act, with globalization of business, the international community here means all the states, all the countries come together, they felt a need of a law that is required to be applicable to all law. Like, for example, whenever we used a word treaty or a convention, that is applicable to the entire world. Why? Because all the countries are getting benefited from them. So here, over the global platform, all the countries came together and they realized that there is a requirement of creating a law, which is known as a cyber law, or which is known as computer-based law, or maybe an electronic commerce. So they led to the adoption of unilateral model of law on electronic commerce by the UN General Assembly. This is also known as model law. Now let me tell you two more things here which are very important. Why? Because here you are trying to understand how this cyber world is interconnected through various countries. Now because of this, the communications, or you can say the commerce, electronic commerce was become very easy. Like if you're buying something from other country, or maybe you are transferring your information to some other country. So here this becomes important. Like if a crime is committed from other country and the impact is on the other country, here you need to have a proper law that is applicable all over the world. So this basically lead to the realization, or this lead to the formation of the Unicentral Model Law on Electronic Commerce 1996, which was applicable to all, and everyone was actually asked to be abide by these rules, and this law would be applicable as all other treaties and all other conventions are under the public international law. Clear? Now, moving forward, law that we just discussed that was applicable to the all over the world, or you can say that is applicable overseas, is divided into certain fundamental principles. So unilateral model is divided into three main principles through which the e-commerce all over the world would be applicable. So here we would be discussing what are the fundamental principles on which the e-commerce is based on, and which led to the requirement of the cyber laws. So the first is known as non-discrimination. As the word itself suggests, non-discrimination means here you're talking about discrimination between any traditional form of the document, physical form of the document, and the electronic form of the document. So the purpose here is to avoid a discrimination. Like if a person is coming with the traditional physical document, that document gets accepted, and if the person is coming with the electronic documents, that document is creating a lot of issues because of which it's not getting accepted. Clear? So here the first principle is non-discrimination. That is, this principle requires the removal of any type of discrimination that is created between any physical traditional document and the electronic document. Moving forward, this principle of non-discrimination, that is the first fundamental principle of e-commerce law under model law of unilateral, here it ensures the validity and enforceability. I want you to remember these words very nicely and very authenticatingly. Why? Because you're ensuring that the validity and the enforceability of a particular document is not at stake. Why? Because that document will not be denied, because its validity and enforceability only on the ground of that it is on the electronic form. If there are other discrepancies, or you can say if there are other faults in that particular document, and then the validity and the enforceability of that document may be at stake. But just because the document is at the electronic form, and just because that document is in the electronic form and not in the traditional physical form, that particular validity or the enforceability will not be challenged. So in the first principle talks about two things. First, there should not be discrimination between any type of physical and the electronic document. Secondly, it's talking about the validity and enforceability. Enforceability and validity will not be dependent upon the electronic form. It can be on the other ground, maybe signature, maybe stamp, maybe format, but not on the ground of the electronic form. Moving forward to the second principles or fundamental principles of the e-commerce law, that is laid down by the model law of Unicetron, that is known as technological neutrality. So what do you mean by technological neutrality? Let me tell you, this principle, the second principle, basically provides and adopted a particular type of law with respect to technology. So it ensures that commercial viability of equally good or better technology will not hamper because the law recognizing one and not the other. Clear? That means if there are two types of technology, let's take an example. There are two types of chain applicable in the market, technologically chain. And if the law is recognizing one and law is not recognizing the second. So just because non-recognition of that particular thing, the commercial viability, or you can also use the word validity of the document, will not be hampered, will not be at stake because the law recognizes one and it does not recognize the other. So this principle basically mandates you to create a neutral effect with respect to the technology that is involved, because we see in this world that on each day we get a new type of technology. There is a better versions. You see the better versions of a particular electronic device each day passing. So just because of this, or maybe you see a various types of different, maybe a Gmail, or when you talk about passing information, you say Gmail, you know, a WhatsApp, and various other things nowadays are prevailing. So just because that one technology has a grant, or maybe one technology has a recognition, the other would not be defeated. This will create problems, and this will defeat a very purpose. Moving forward, this also ensures the rapid pace of development of technology does not lead to become of old technology as reluctant. So this was the whole idea of the second principle, technological neutrality. That means all law recognizing one and not the other will not have any impact. So moving forward, the first is non-discrimination, second is technological neutrality. Moving forward, that is known as functional equivalence. Now, what do you mean by functional equivalence? Here, you must have heard different types of words when it comes to the paper-based documents. You must have words, the document should be in writing, the document should be original, the document should be signed, the document should be stamped. So such type of things will not affect any electronic communication. So this principle, basically functional equivalence, will let down that sets out the corresponding criteria for the electronic communication. So the terms like writing, stamped, signed, original, etc. are specific to paper documents, and they will not get any type of problems. They will not create basically any type of problems for the electronic documents. Now, after studying the three principles, that is the first one that talks about non-discrimination, second talks about technological neutrality, third talks about functional equivalence. So here, now let me take you an example to make you more understand about the functional equivalence. Like, for example, if you see Article 8 of this model Unicetron that we are studying, here Article 8 is talking about originality. Now, what do you mean by originality? That means there should be a reliable assurance of the integrity of the information, right? From time to time when it was first generated in the final form. So the law requires any type of information that to be presented or to be retained in the original form. The requirement is met by the data message. This article is very big. I'm giving you the original idea of the originality. There exists a reliable assurance as to the integrity of the information, that is from the time it was first created. You know, you can create an electronically created document as many as times you want. So when it was first time created, that reliability should be there. Moving forward, okay, so these are the references, these are the links, these are the books from I got all these materials from. You all can look into these things, you all can see. Of course, this is not an exhaustive list, but you all can refer these books. These are must read books, right? So thank you. If any doubts are there, you can definitely contact me, and thank you so much for listening.